It's not really morning, not really afternoon, so I will wish everyone a good lunchtime and say a quick thank you to everyone who has given up their lunch hour to join this webinar. So my name is Jason Buttrick. I'm a partner at Dechert, and I have the privilege of moderating this webinar. Today's topic is workplace investigations, and I am both relieved and delighted to be joined by three unquestionable experts in the area. From our employment team at Dechert, we have Jenny McGrandall, who will be well known to many of you. She has more than 20 years' experience as a barrister and solicitor and has probably handled more investigations than my children have had hot dinners. And from the eminent Barristers Chambers 11 KBW, we have Amy Rogers. Amy has been Employment Junior of the Year for both Chambers and Partners and Legal 500. She is so impressive that she is in a separate standalone star individual category in Chambers Directory. And finally, from our regulatory department at Dechert, we have Colin Sharpsmith. Colin is also a partner in the firm and deals with all aspects of financial regulation relating to firms and individuals, and he's the man to turn to in a tight spot. So, enough about our illustrious panel, I hear you say. Tell us about workplace investigations. And the plan today is to walk you through the investigation process from beginning to end, highlighting some of the more tricky areas that we come across in practice. And you may say to me, well, why do we need workplace investigations? Well, they could be needed in any number of situations. Typically though, you'll have a workplace investigation to investigate a grievance raised by a member of staff, to investigate alleged staff misconduct, to maybe investigate a whistleblowing complaint, to investigate apparent compliance breaches, or maybe more generally, just to look into the culture and practices of an organization. But the question will always be, who's going to do the investigation? Amy, how do you go about choosing who's going to do your investigation?
Thanks, Jason. Well, I actually think you need to ask a prior question, which is, why am I conducting this investigation in the first place? And in one sense, the answer to that is easy. I mean, in most cases, you're investigating because you want to know what's happened in a particular respect. But it's never that straightforward. I mean, in truth, investigations always have a fundamental purpose. And that might be, for example, well, I have an employment issue and I need to conduct a disciplinary investigation or a grievance investigation. And the answer there may be, well, when working out who your investigator should be, you start with your internal policies and see what they provide or dictate. But if you're not in that sort of situation, if it's more nuanced or the scope of the investigation is bigger, you need to stand back and ask, am I conducting this investigation because I want to report to a regulator, say, and Colin will speak to that shortly. But in that case, you may be looking at an external investigator, perhaps. Are you conducting an investigation because you have an internal culture issue, as you were describing, Jason? Maybe you want a report that will go to the board. Well, there, the nature of the investigation and why you're conducting it may well drive you to one type of external or internal investigator over another. Or do you have a much more internal issue for which it's obvious once you've identified that the purpose of the report is to find out what happened in a particular respect and then put in measures to ensure it isn't repeated, that an internal investigator is your best bet? But in all those cases, you need to start, I think, by asking yourself, why am I conducting this investigation and what end result do I want to achieve?
Thank you, Amy, and thank you for making me feel just like I'm at home, where I ask a question, I'm told that's the wrong question. So let's go to Jenny. Jenny, we know now we've got to look at the purposes and the stakeholders. With all that in mind, what factors do you need to think about when you're choosing an investigator?
Well, there are a number of factors. It won't surprise you to learn. So first of all, you need to consider what skills and expertise do you need your investigator to have? And for example, they might need knowledge of a particular sector or a particular area of law, for example, discrimination law. And then an obvious point, but do they have time to do it? And that will apply equally for an internal or an external investigator. Because we all know from sometimes bitter experience that investigations can take a long time and take up a huge amount of the investigator's time. So they really do need to be able to dedicate the majority of their time to the investigation. And that might mean if you're going externally that you really do need to ask some searching questions of the investigator to ensure that they haven't got things on the horizon. For example, if you're using counsel, a huge trial, which is going to get in the way of the investigation. Is the investigator going to be seen as credible to external stakeholders, your board, as Amy just mentioned, or your regulator? And when thinking about that, that may mean you're either going to someone very senior internally or using a well-respected and known investigator externally. The nature of the allegations is also likely to have an impact upon who you instruct as your investigator. So if they're very serious allegations, and if they've been made against very senior individuals within the organisation, then that is going to have an impact, because you're going to need someone, again, very, very senior, well-respected, to be carrying out that investigation. So in terms of the internal or external investigator that Amy touched upon, there are a number of pros and cons for either. An internal investigator is going to be cheaper, obviously, although you need to factor in that it's going to take a lot of time and resource of that individual and take them away from their day job, presumably. That individual is going to know your business very well. They will have easy access to documents that may be relevant and also to people that they need to interview. But in terms of your external investigator, although it is going to add to the expense, potentially the time, in terms of that credibility, that giving a sense of independence that you may not have if you use an internal investigator, those can be good reasons for choosing an external investigator.
Thank you, Jenny. Let's bring Colin in here, because Colin, what are your views? Who should we get to investigate? Internal, external?
Yes. I would reiterate what Amy said at the start, that it really does depend on what you are trying to what behavior you're looking to investigate, what the purpose of your report is going to be. But the relevant consideration, if you have the good fortune to work for a firm which is regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority, is going to be, is this something of which the regulator needs to be made aware? And if not at this stage, at what point is the trigger when it becomes appropriate to bring the FCA into the picture? So it may well be appropriate to commence an investigation internally, and these have a habit sometimes of evolving, and firms, particularly in more complex investigations, need to bring in external advisors, external expertise on particular areas. Certainly, if it's something which impacts a senior individual who's regulated individually by the FCA, or indeed a member of staff who's otherwise subject to the FCA's conduct rules, and the allegations go to their fitness and propriety, then there'll be considerations as to whether or not there's any notices that need to be submitted in respect of that individual, or if what's being investigated discloses more broader issues in terms of the management of the firm or its operations. The FCA always has the power, even if you are conducting an internal investigation and letting them know, to require a firm to appoint a skilled person. So that's an individual appointed under Section 166 of FSMA. The FCA is a panel of firms of expert investigators who conduct those investigations. Firms have the privilege of paying for that. So that's another consideration in terms of the timing as to whether or not firms may want themselves to get ahead of the process, take control over it, appoint an external investigator where they can frame the scope of reference themselves and keep the FCA up to date as needed.
Thank you, Colin. So we now know we've looked into our purposes, our stakeholders, we've decided on our investigates, but let's get a bit more granular. Jenny, how do you actually go about instructing an investigator?
Well, if you're using an internal investigator, you're probably not going to need a lengthy letter of engagement or terms of reference. But nevertheless, the internal investigator does need to be clear as to the scope of the investigation. So there should be something in place, even if it's just a short email setting out the parameters of the investigation. For your external investigator, there is more likely to be a formal letter of engagement in place that will set out or summarise the allegations or cross-refer to the grievance letter. It will give a time scale, so that's really important. Tell the investigator when you hope the whole thing will be completed by. It will set out things like, for example, it sounds obvious, but how do you want the findings presented? Usually a written report, but not always. To whom should that report be sent? Should it be sent to multiple people? Who's going to be the point of contact for the investigator? Because it does help to have an admin person who can do things like set up appointments for the interviews and find documents for the investigator. And then more legalistic things, which you might also want to include, like what is the standard of proof going to be, likely to be the balance of probabilities, how will conflicts of evidence be resolved? And importantly also, what findings are you wanting the investigator to make? Is it going to be factual findings, or do you actually want them to draw conclusions in respect of the grievance, whatever it is that has been raised? And significantly, do you want the investigator to make recommendations, or do you want that to be left to people internally?
Thanks, Jen. So sounds like we need to formally instruct, and one of the things we need to cover is what the investor is going to be doing, or the scope of the investigation. And Amy, what do we need to think about when we're deciding the scope of the investigation itself?
Well, there's a whole range of considerations that come in there, Jason. I mean, I sometimes think it's helpful to think about the potential range of investigations that could be conducted along a sliding scale. You know, at one end of that scale, you could conceivably instruct an investigator just to summarize the evidence, not even to make formal findings of fact. A little bit further along the scale, you have what Jenny was describing as a fact-finding investigation, where the investigator reaches conclusions to a standard that you specify as to what actually happened. Although, pausing there, even there, you may need to be clear with the investigator what facts they're to be looking at. Just take one example. If you have a whistleblowing debate, for example, do you want your investigator to be looking at whether a particular employee was subjected to detriment for having blown the whistle? Or do you want them to be looking at the substance of the underlying allegation that they say they were blowing the whistle about? So even where you're just talking about a fact-find investigation, you want to be clear from the outset what facts are in scope and what aren't. Further along the spectrum, you would have an investigation where the investigator is not only fact-finding, but reaching conclusions as to the outcome. Was there wrongdoing? Was there discrimination? Is there a cultural issue? So on, so on. And then finally, you might have an investigator who goes further and says, well, these are my recommendations for how to solve the issues I've identified, if I identify any. And no surprise to hear, you know, which of those boxes, which of those places along the spectrum are most appropriate will depend on, back to where we started, what the purpose of the investigation is, but also the particular corporate's concern about the control they want over the process. So, for example, there will be some entities for whom, for a particular investigation, they would want somebody else to do the fact finding, but they absolutely would want to do the decision making themselves as to the consequences. There'll be other entities, other circumstances, other investigations where, in fact, it's preferable to have the investigator reaching the final conclusions, potentially because of the sensitivity and the seniority of the individuals involved and the risk of allegations that fall out of it. But that is quite a complex and nuanced assessment that always has to go back to, well, why am I doing this? What's the purpose of this investigation?
Well, that's very clear. But in practical terms, you've instructed the investigator, they know the scope of the investigation, terms of reference have been set. What happens now? Tell us what happens now.
Then you get into the who, what, when. And I think my starting point is there should always be a plan. There should be an investigation plan drawn up by the investigator and that is consistent with the terms of reference. Because unless the investigator directs their minds at the outset of the process to who am I going to speak to? What documents do I want to see? What order am I going to take these individuals and documents in? What's my overall time frame to report? You risk having an investigation that either develops a momentum of its own, or, which is equally problematic, one that drags and drags, because actually it's only as the process goes on that those involved really engage with the evidence gathering entailed. So for me, the starting point is always draw up an investigation plan, And as part of that, and as Jenny was saying, just to underscore, having somebody appointed who can act as an administrator to the investigator so that the meeting arrangements, the practicalities are taken out of their hands.
Okay. So what about that messaging? What about the process of talking to people and confidentiality?
That's really difficult. And it's really difficult because there are so many competing considerations there. I mean, you have individuals who are giving evidence in an investigation and they obviously think, well, I want this to be confidential. I don't want my frank views to be shared with my colleagues or others. Equally, as the employer or corporate conducting the investigation, you obviously can't promise that anything that's said to an investigator will remain confidential forevermore, because you well know there might be a tribunal process. If there are disciplinary allegations, fairness may require that particular accounts are put to the person involved. There's all sorts of circumstances in which evidence given to an investigator won't be confidential. And that gives rise to the messaging question, you know, who should be grappling with those issues and how should they be grappled with? And again, no one size fits all answer, unsurprisingly. But very often, I think it's best for the employer, the corporate, to take the initiative to introduce the investigator to the complainant, if there's a complainant, and to other key relevant parties at the outset, and to give some indication as to the extent to which evidence will be kept confidential, to which the honest answer is often, it will be as confidential as we can manage consistently with the fairness of the process, which isn't a completely satisfactory answer, but is a common sense one.
Yeah, I follow that. I mean, it's the employer's investigation, really. So
exactly.
But then I suppose it's slightly nuanced if there's an external investigator where there's likely to be less involvement from the employer. Quick question for you, Jenny. If you're going to have interviews with the complainant and witnesses, is there any particular place we should have it? Does it matter? Oh, and you're on mute, I think.
Sorry, it's always going to be me. It will depend on the circumstances. Increasingly, I find these days investigators are carrying out their interviews by teams, which is obviously more convenient for people, saves on time and cost and that sort of thing, and perhaps is a bit less intimidating for the witnesses as well. So that's quite an effective method. But sometimes investigators do prefer to meet with particular individuals in person, in which case meeting rooms can be made available at the employer's premises, or the investigator may prefer to have the meeting somewhere more neutral. And in particular circumstances, if it's the complainant that's being interviewed and they are feeling intimidated by the person against whom the complaints are made, it may be preferable to get the individual out of the workplace. So it really is going to depend on the circumstances.
But it sounds like common sense, thoughtful approach, can't go wrong. But what about the employer? So let's say you're investigating allegations against an individual, whether a grievance or a misconduct allegation. And the question is then, well, should you be suspending the person about whom the allegations are made or not? Jenny.
Well, this is something you'll hear employment lawyers say a lot, but a suspension should never be a knee-jerk reaction, and it applies to an investigation as in all other circumstances. Although, unfortunately, employers do often automatically assume that the person against whom a complaint has been made should be suspended. But the problem with doing that is that it can indicate to that person, before the investigation has even begun, that the outcome has been predetermined. So you need to factor that into any decision. However, there may be good reasons for suspending an individual. For example, it may actually enable the investigation if complaints have been made by various individuals and there is, as I mentioned previously, that fear factor, feeling of intimidation. And if that individual is still around in the workplace every day, it may make people afraid to speak frankly to an investigator. It may also protect the business, because if very serious allegations have been made, for example, bullying allegations, you may feel that actually it is not appropriate to have that individual remain in the workplace until those allegations have been investigated, because it may lead to further instances of bullying. So again, it's going to depend on the individual circumstances.
It's funny you said that, because my experience is quite often employers want to suspend even for very minor issues of misconduct, and then sometimes very serious misconduct when someone's important to the business, they don't want to suspend. And there are ways of dealing with it, because suspension seems to have a sort of a connotation which is negative, but there are ways of dealing with it by agreement, having a period of paid leave. But actually, let's turn to Colin on this. Colin, what does a regulator think of suspension?
Yes. Well, I mean, it really depends on what the individual's function is within the firm, and what is the alleged misconduct that's being investigated. At one end, the FCA will take any issues regarding the safeguarding of clients and customers' assets and other issues regarding competence in market contact extremely seriously. But some of the more complicated investigations are concerning issues around market conduct. And in those situations, you can't actually, I mean, particularly if it relates to allegations of an insider dealing ring or other financial crime, you can't tip off the suspect of an investigation. So there have been instances where the FCA has been informed about an investigation and has asked the firm to put the brakes on or keep a very, very tight control over the number of people who are conducting that investigation, and certainly not to alert the suspects. In other situations, the FCA will positively ask for why is this person still in place, given the seriousness of these allegations that have been made about them, and the fact that they are responsible for one of the controlled functions within the firm. And whenever a decision has been taken either to suspend or not to suspend, it's important that the firm is able to justify the decision that it's taken to its regulator in the case that we're going to be asked those questions.
Yeah, presumably if the regulator is saying, why aren't you suspending, then it might be something that needs further consideration. Yeah.
Yes, they would need to be able to provide an answer at least.
Yeah. I mean, while we're on this topic, if there is some sort of external or regulatory investigation, can you still conduct your internal investigation? What do you think, Colin?
Yes, you certainly can. And in fact, the FCA in its enforcement guidance specifically talks about that. There's a whole section of FCA's enforcement guide where it talks specifically about firm-led or firm-initiated investigations. So it will often be quite helpful to the regulator that there is an internal or indeed externally appointed investigation taking place by the firm, and the FCA has not used its statutory powers under 166. That said, the FCA may well want to understand the terms of reference of that investigation and to be kept up to speed with how it's progressing. But that can be helpful if you have an investigation which may disclose conduct for which the business itself or individuals may receive a penalty. So there are discounts for sharing information, cooperating. The FCA, the firm itself is under an obligation, and indeed individuals who are regulated are under an obligation to inform the FCA of anything which it reasonably expects notice. And if you think it's likely that this sort of allegation that's being made, if the misconduct is shown to have occurred, would make the firm liable for a penalty, then getting ahead of it and keeping the regulator informed, it means that you would be entitled to take that into account in mitigation when the FCA comes to determine what the level of penalty would be.
Very clear. Thank you very much. Should we move on? So let's get into a bit more granular detail about the investigation interviews themselves. Maybe Jenny, you can help me with this. Is someone who's being interviewed for investigation entitled to be accompanied to that interview?
Well, there's no general right for your ordinary witness to be accompanied, but arguably the person who, if it's a grievance and you're interviewing the person who's raised a grievance, which is likely, then arguably they have a right to be accompanied because it counts as a fact-finding meeting to which there is a right to be accompanied. But regardless of the strict legal position, it might be beneficial to offer a right to be accompanied anyway to anyone who's being interviewed, not just the complainants, because you may have particular witnesses who, for whatever reason, perhaps for a safeguarding reason, might need to be accompanied. Or it may be something that you consider making as a reasonable adjustment for someone who's feeling particularly anxious about the process, or perhaps is has mental health issues or is signed off work at that time with stress or anxiety. If there's a possibility, if you're investigating the person against whom allegations have been made, that it will proceed to a disciplinary, then it may be prudent to offer that person the right to be accompanied, because the implications of that meeting are potentially significant. And then going one step further, although typically whenever we're asked, should we allow a lawyer to attend these meetings, our answer will be absolutely no way. There may be circumstances in which it is appropriate to allow someone to be accompanied by their lawyer. For example, if a potential outcome of something which happens after the investigation will have career limiting consequences.
If I could just go back to something you said earlier about the need to consider welfare issues, there's a question about disability, discrimination, if the person bringing the complaint is themselves, or the person being who's a subject of investigation is themselves, you know, suffering from a disability, you might need to make yourself aware of medical information, you might need to allow that person more time, etc. But won't that have an impact? We heard before from Amy about the need to control the timing. In fact, Amy, what happens to the timing in those situations?
Well, Jason, it's one of those things you have to consider on a case-by-case basis. I mean, certainly you're right to say that if you've got a complainant or potentially another witness who has a need for reasonable adjustments, or because of some of the reasons that Jenny was touching on, there are other complexities to the investigation that mean that particular steps are needed to safeguard witnesses, then that will inevitably have some knock-on effect on timing, because you might, for example, need to break meetings down into shorter bursts. You might need to give advance notice in some cases of some of the questions that are going to be covered, although there are competing views on that depending on the circumstances. And all of those things can overall mean a longer investigation. But ultimately, if you are dealing with a complainant or a witness with a disability and reasonable adjustments are necessary, they are necessary. And the important thing is to get ahead of that process, to identify them early and to ensure that they're factored into your overall investigation plan and that they don't come as an unpleasant surprise along the way.
Because I recall being involved in an investigation once, and the challenge we had was that the individual who we needed to interview, or at least the investigator needed to interview, was suffering hugely from mental health illnesses, and we were struggling to arrange a time. But at the same time, as having medical information saying the person not fit to participate, there was medical information saying the person won't get better until you completed the process. So I can see how it could put you into a bind. There's no quick answer there, I think, so let's move on. And we heard Jenny speaking earlier about the fact that even though we normally say no legal representation at internal internal meetings, there is a possibility of being entitled to be accompanied by a lawyer if the potential outcome could have career-limiting consequences. And the career-limiting consequences I'm thinking about are obviously those which are regulatory. So, Colin, what are your views on the right to be accompanied?
Yes, certainly. Jason, that's the FCA, of course, has the power to call people in and interview them themselves, particularly if there are if the individual is senior or is responsible for has regulatory responsibility for one of the control functions within the firm. And the FCA grants employees in those circumstances the right to be accompanied, the right to legal representation if there are allegations being made against them which could impact on their fitness and propriety. So that is a relevant consideration. Yes, you're right, particularly if there are suggestions that are being put to the employee which could encroach on their honesty and integrity, then they may well want to be accompanied, and that's something that the FCA would permit.
Is there anything we need to think about, Jenny, if we are going to have someone there who's a legal representative.
Oh, I love it when you go off script, Jason. I would imagine you'd be wanting to emphasise confidentiality of the process and to be ensuring that there are sort of strict parameters around what's going to be done with documents and things like that. And also, I would imagine you would treat the lawyer in a similar way to a companion, and therefore it should be made clear that the legal representative cannot answer questions that are directed to the person being interviewed.
Thank you. I went off script, but you read my mind. It's exactly the point. We had once a union member who was entitled to come to or asked to come to to an investigative meeting, and we had a real challenge there because we said, well, we need you to confirm you're going to keep the information you received confidential. And there was a bit of a battle because, of course, the right to accompaniment wouldn't necessarily involve them giving up. But we came to a solution which involved some sort of soft undertaking which was satisfactory to the client. But sticking with you, Jenny, just in terms of more granular details, you have your interview, your lawyer may be there, maybe not, or your companion may be there, maybe not. But how do you record it? Would you have a transcript? Would you make a note? What's your view?
My own view is that you should get a transcript. I mean, there are some investigators who will insist upon that. And so I suppose that's what I've become used to now. And again, it will add to expense. It will add to logistical issues, potentially, because you've got another person to factor into availability. But it does then mean, obviously, you've got a complete, accurate, impartial record of the meeting. If you don't go with a transcriber, then you can record the meeting, but then you still need somebody to ideally make a note of it afterwards. Alternatively, you can have a note taker present, and that's usually some poor person from HR who has to do that. But the problem with that is that it can lead to a suggestion that the notes are not impartial. And more often than not, it will lead to an argument about whether the contents of the notes are accurate. And you then end up in a protracted debate about, you know, what was or wasn't said. And usually the only way of resolving that is to agree that there will be two sets of notes, which is obviously far from ideal for the poor investigator.
Yeah, I know that's your view. My view is always take a note of the meeting rather than have a transcript or a recording, because it just adds much more paperwork to the case and to the in the investigation itself. And people don't talk in pure sentences. Will include lots of ums and ahs, just like I am doing now, and half sentences and irrelevancies. Whereas with a note, you can really hone the note to the super relevant parts. But I completely agree. I don't think I can recall an investigation where notes of meetings were accepted without some commentary. But while we're on this topic, Colin, is there a view from the regulator's camp about what you should be doing in terms of keeping a record?
If it was going to be a regulatory appointed investigator under Section 166 of FSMA, then there will be a transcript of interviews and meetings. The regulator will want to see that, and that will be a standard way in which one of those firms appointed under the statutory power would operate. But otherwise, if you're conducting an internal investigation, there's no stipulation that you have to. That you have to have a stenographer present, have a full verbatim transcription of everything that was said in the interviews. And yes, Jason, to your point, you may well want to have, particularly if you're handling it internally, a note which focuses on the salient points and what people had said, rather than a verbatim account where sometimes there might be slips of the tongue, which I've seen instances where in investigations where the regulator has leapt on a particular phrase which was just tossed out glibly in an interview, but is particularly unhelpful either to the individual under investigation or the firm itself. So that's a relevant consideration.
I think Colin said that because in an interview he mentioned the legal the legal principle of being bound to rights. But let's move on from there.
Absolutely.
And Jenny, what about other practical considerations? What else do we need to think about when we're dealing with our process?
Well, one of the first things is how you communicate the allegations to the various people who are being interviewed. One way of doing that would be to share the grievance letter, at least with the individual against whom complaints have been made. They often feel, unsurprisingly, that they have the right to see the allegations that have been made and about which they are being questioned. But obviously that letter is often a very sensitive and confidential document, and the individual who has raised agreements may not want it to be circulated, understandably. So usually at the start of the process, the investigator will, you hope they will, have drawn up a summary of the allegations, a schedule of allegations. So that may be a useful compromise, that you just share that schedule of allegations with the person against whom complaints have been made. Similarly, with other witnesses, you would just share the allegations that are relevant to them from that schedule. So they at least have a vague idea of what they're going to be questioned about, and the interview is likely to be more useful as a result. Linked to that is, should you give the witnesses advance notice of the questions that the investigator is going to ask? And again, there's a difference of opinion there. Some investigators are happy to do that. Others absolutely will not share the questions ahead of time, because their view is that they will get a more honest account if the witness has not had time to think about the answer beforehand and perhaps even put together a suggested response with their lawyer. But you can understand why those participating in an investigation may feel very apprehensive about the interview and are not happy about the fact that they're not going to know it in advance. And a way of perhaps alleviating their concerns is to suggest that they can put together a statement ahead of the interview, which at least means they have the opportunity to put forward their version of events in their own words, and they can do it at their own leisure, not when they're under pressure and perhaps having questions fired at them. And another issue to consider is what you do with documents. To what extent will documents be shared with witnesses ahead of time? I mean, that really is going to be a matter for the investigator. But if a witness raises that, I think it is fair enough that they should at least be sent, you know, key background documents ahead of the meeting. And again, it may make the interview a more useful process if they've had advanced sight of those documents.
Well, that's absolutely my experience. So if an investigator wants a meeting to go smoothly, ambushing someone with new documents they haven't seen before doesn't really help. And this is not an adversarial process where you're trying to catch people out. You're trying to get to the truth. Maybe you don't give them a list of the questions, but let them see the documents in advance before you have your meeting, so they've got a chance to refresh their memory. So is there anything else that we need to think about, though, Colin, if there was, say, a parallel regulatory investigation going on at the same time, or is, we can just plow on as we wish?
Certainly it doesn't mean that an internal investigation needs to stop if there is a parallel regulatory investigation, regulator-led investigation going on at the same time. Crucial thing in those circumstances to consider is communication with the regulator, keeping the FCA fully up to speed, and trying to manage that process as carefully as possible. Obviously, once you've reached the point where there is a parallel regulatory investigation taking place, then the threshold for full disclosure has already been met, and so the FCA will require a lot of engagement from the firm, and it'll be in the firm's interest really to try and lead those discussions as much as possible to keep it focused on the salient issues to avoid any potential submission creep.
Well, thank you very much. So Jenny, we touched upon documents before. We were saying that an investigator might want to share documents in advance with witnesses, but I think we have to have a first stage, which is how do they get the documents?
Well, I think the most important thing to do is to speak with the investigator and ask what they want to do in terms of documents. Often by the time the investigator is appointed, external lawyers may have been involved in the process for some time. I've often found that's the case. And so we already have a very good knowledge of the grievance. We already have a lot of documentation. So in the past, we have put together a bundle of documents for the investigator containing the sort of key background documents so that they can hit the ground running when they meet with the complainant, and they usually meet with the complainant first. However, that has backfired in the past. Some investigators do not like that. And in particular, some complainants don't like that because they feel that the employer's lawyers are having too much involvement, too much control over the investigation. So that's why I think it is important to, and again, that might be in your, you know, be included within the terms of engagement almost, you know, what's going to happen about documents. But even if you do put together that initial bundle of documents, an investigation is obviously an evolving process. The investigator is going to think of other documents, and through speaking with witnesses, it's going to emerge that, you know, there are other documents that exist and that are relevant. And often following a meeting, the witness will provide the investigator with further documents that have been discussed during the meeting. So often by the end of an investigation, there will be a vast amount of documentation. In fact, with one investigation I was involved in a year ago, it took the investigator about 3 days to append all the documents to the investigation report. There were so many. So I think it's, it's something that you just have to, you can't really decide at the outset, right, this is what we're going to do. It will evolve. And I think, again, that's why it's really important to have that point of contact for the investigator, because they can help retrieve any documents that the investigator might need.
So whether it's an internal investigator or an external investigator, they'll presumably, the investigator will be thinking about what documents they will need to see under their investigation plan. The employer will be thinking about what documents they want to give to the investigator to assist the investigation process themselves. And then separately, the investigator will be asking anybody, the complainants or any witnesses, if they have relevant documents. So all these different avenues where documents can come from, which can lead to somebody spending 3 days just appending documents, which seems a little bit excessive. But one thing that I've seen, and I know you've seen over the past several years, is the advent of data subject access requests. And I just want to ask you, how does that play out in an investigation process?
Well, it's not uncommon for an employee to raise a grievance and in parallel issue a subject access request. That can then cause issues with timing, because more often than not, the employer will ask for the 2-month extension that's permitted under GDPR. So they have 3 months to comply with that request. And the complainant will then sometimes ask if there can be a delay in the investigation so that they get hold of all their personal data and can provide the investigator with that. That should be resisted at all costs, not least because the investigation, if it's being done externally and it's a complex matter with multiple witnesses, it will still be going on in 3 months' time anyway. The other issue is that, I mean, it will often, unsurprisingly, it will give rise to a lot of documents that are relevant, because usually the employer will conduct, this is certainly the way we tend to approach a subject access request, rather than giving the employee all their personal data, which can be immense, we will devise a series of keyword search terms, which are usually drawn from the allegations in the grievance. So there is likely to be a lot of documentation that is relevant and that will need to go to the investigator. And often it will go to the investigator via the employee. But when the employee gets the data, a lot of it will have been redacted because there will be third-party personal data in it, which you're obliged to redact. Also, of course, any privileged data will have been redacted. And so that can add a further level of complication, because the investigator may come back to the employer and say, well, I've got all these documents which are seemingly relevant, but half of them have got great big chunks of black in them. So can I please have unredacted copies, which then obviously involves a further process where someone has to review them to work out, well, you know, is that redacted text relevant to the investigation, or is there stuff that we do still need to withhold because it's privileged or it's irrelevant or particularly sensitive or whatever.
Right, so the starting point is, yes, commonly there'll be a DSAR, commonly it'll be targeted at the same time as a grievance or at the same time maybe as a disciplinary process, but the two should be run separately ideally, and but expect there to be complications from it. And one thing you touched upon there, which was interesting, was privilege. And we haven't talked about privilege at all, so I'm going to ask Amy, is anything about this privileged? Can the notes be privileged? Can evidence be privileged? I don't know. What? Tell us about privilege.
Oh, that is such a difficult and thorny question. And Jason, I think realistically, there are two answers to it. There's a technical black letter answer, and there's also a real world answer. I mean, starting with the technical answer, yes, of course, it is possible to conduct a privileged investigation. And separating out the different types of privilege, that might be an investigation that's subject to litigation privilege, because the dominant purpose of what is being done is with regards to actual or contemplated litigation. That is possible. It is also theoretically possible to have an investigation conducted by a lawyer for the purposes of giving legal advice, where at least some of the investigation is subject to legal advice privilege. The problem is that the cases in which those are cast iron categories are few and far between. And you can have a terrible time if you start off with an investigation that is potentially privileged, but it isn't really privileged. And then you have requests for the documents that went to the investigator, and then the privilege gets unpicked. And you know, everybody ends up in a place that they didn't want to start in, which is why my own starting point would be, unless there are particular circumstances that drive you to do something more extreme, ordinarily, it's much better to have a transparent and open process and to assume that the investigation and the evidence given to the investigator are not privileged, because then you know where you stand and everything is conducted on that basis. If that's not where you started, and if there are difficult questions around the edges, well, you know, the bottom line is, unless you're in a litigation privileged investigation, it is generally pretty difficult for certainly transcripts of witness interviews and certain underlying documents to be treated as privilege. But all the more reason why the real world answer is, if you can, treat it as a transparent, open exercise.
And what about taking legal advice? Can the employer take legal advice, which is privileged? Can the investigator take legal advice, which is privileged? Or does it make a difference if the investigator is internal or external?
Absolutely, the employer can take legal advice, and absolutely the investigator can take legal advice. But really there, the watchword is to be deliberate about the way you're going about that and to be careful. Because as you'll know, certainly for legal advice privilege, legal advice within a corporate entity would attach to communications between the lawyer and the client that is authorised to take the advice. So you need to be clear, who is that client? Who is taking the advice? And then making sure that if that group of individuals is given legal advice in relation to an investigation, it isn't shared more widely within the organisation, isn't shared with others for whom the consequence may be the privilege is lost. But it's quite an interesting question when an investigator wants legal advice as to who should give that advice. Should it be an internal lawyer? It could be. It could be. Is it better for it to be an external lawyer and for that to be a separate channel of legal advice to the advice that is given to the company? And that is certainly where it can be arranged and where the cost isn't an issue, the cleanest and simplest way to go about it. But as I said at the outset, yes, possible, but needs care to ensure that privilege isn't inadvertently lost along the way.
Thank you. And I remember hearing Jenny giving some very good practical advice to an investigator to say, have two folders, one with privileged information and one with non-privileged information. I'm not sure the investigator did that. Or if they did, they forgot about it. But certainly that was the advice. But what about earlier drafts of a report? Can that be privileged, Jenny? Oh, Jenny's lost her
voice. So sorry. She's my mouse now. Yeah, that is a very, very good question. And it is, of course, fine for whoever's producing the report, particularly if it's someone internally, for that report to be reviewed before it is released. And quite often, we would like to think we can have some useful input into that report. But you always have to have in the back of your mind, even though obviously as part of a grievance investigation, you're hoping it won't end up with litigation, it may well do. And so you've always got to think about what is going to be disclosable down the line. And going back to what Amy has just said about ensuring that you're really careful about you know, your client group and to whom you're circulating documents, it's incredibly important with early drafts of the report that they are not circulated beyond the investigator and the lawyer, because otherwise that earlier draft or drafts of the report will potentially be, or almost certainly will be, disclosable. And if the lawyers have ended up making quite a few changes to the report before it's released to the employee, that may not look ideal. There may be a suggestion that the lawyers have influenced the outcome or had too much influence in the process altogether. And it's quite clear from a relatively recent case of Chakrabarty that you cannot apply legal privilege retrospectively. So even if you've had legal input into a later draft of the report, it will not give earlier drafts retrospectively privilege if they've been circulating their way around the employer.
So just to be clear, the final draft had legal advice and made changes, but the earlier draft had been circulated and wasn't privileged, and therefore it was open to the employee in that case to look at the differences between the two reports and work out what legal advice had been given. Okay, well, that's not ideal. but while we're with you, Jenny, moving on to other non-ideal things, how do you manage a situation where an employee or a witness asks for confidentiality or anonymity, easy for me to say, as part of an investigation?
Well, Amy's already touched on that at the start, and it is incredibly difficult because often that is exactly what an individual will want, particularly the person making the allegations, but it's just not something that can be promised, or it's very difficult to follow through with it. If a witness is particularly concerned about reprisals, then you can potentially offer that the statement will be given on, or a statement will be prepared, and that it will be done so on an anonymous basis, basis. Of course, it's not necessarily the case that the person against whom allegations are made, or even the complainant, will get to see transcripts of a meeting or statements as part of a disciplinary, probably, but not necessarily as part of a grievance, although they are likely to be disclosable documents down the line. But the problem, of course, with anonymizing anything is that the chances are somebody is going to be able to work out pretty easily from what has been said who the individual is. So the reality is that it's very difficult to anonymize evidence in such a way that the identity of the witness will not become known.
I suppose the key is to be clear about what the use of the statement or the information is going to be at the end of the day. Because if the person is told up front, then they can decide whether to participate or not. But if they don't participate, that probably gives rise to other problems. having gone through now the purpose of the investigation, the stakeholders involved, the appointment of the choosing of an investigator, the appointment of an investigator, the terms of reference. They've gone through an investigation plan now. They've looked at documents. They've interviewed witnesses. They've been very careful about telling them what's going to happen to them when they've given them their evidence. They've thought about welfare issues and they've thought about timing. they've collated their documents. They've dealt with the fallout from visas. They've dispensed with the possibility of getting privilege. They get to the end of the day, they're sitting down, and they've been told as part of their terms of reference, we want a written report. Well, what are they going to put in the report? Jenny, what are they going to put in the report?
Well, a good place to start is the investigator's remit. Hopefully that should be consistent with whatever was put in the terms of reference. A summary of the allegations is also helpful, and if there are many, many allegations, then it may be best just to cross-refer to the schedule of allegations if that has been drawn up. It's also helpful for the investigator to set out in summary what they've done as part of their investigation, so listing all the interviews that have taken place, with whom and when they took place, and whether there was more than one interview. A summary of what documents they have reviewed as part of the investigation. And then generally, the most logical and clearest way of structuring the report is to break it down by allegation, set out what the allegation is, set out a summary of the evidence, and then come to some kind of conclusion, whether that's a factual finding or or a determination. And then it can be helpful to have to sort of bring everything together at the end in a conclusion. And if the investigator has been asked to do so, to include recommendations at that point. And then, of course, you also need to address what you're going to do with the documents. So sometimes, particularly if there are many, many documents, the investigator will just perhaps append a list of all the documents that they have considered, or they might attach the key documents only. Or in some instances, like the one I described earlier, they will append literally every single document that has been given to them. In which case you will end up with, you know, often bundles of documents that go with the report, which are paginated to make cross-referencing within the report and subsequently a little easier.
And what about distributing the report? I've written the report, it's got a contents, who's it gonna go to?
Well, again, that might have been already set out in your terms of reference, and it is something that you need to think about carefully. And sometimes the complainant will have input. I had a case once where the complainant took a very proactive part in the process that was going to be followed as part of the investigation, and was most insistent that A as to who would receive a copy. She wanted to know exactly who would receive a copy and where it was going to be sent, and also wanted to ensure that the report was sent simultaneously to her and the employer. And sometimes the investigator will give the employer advance sight of the report, often as a means of checking whether there are any facts or anything if there are any factual inaccuracies in the report which should be corrected before it's finalised. And that can be very sensible, and it can be helpful for the employer to have advanced sight of things before it is distributed to the complainant. But the problem with that is, again, this whole thing of the perceptions to the independence of the investigation, and can lead to a suggestion by the employee that the employer has had too much input, has been able to potentially have some influence on the outcome. So no right or wrong answer, but these are just factors that you should bear in mind when you're considering how the report is going to be distributed.
And thank you, Jenny. And we've got only a few minutes left, but time enough, I think, for Amy to help us with what happens next once the report's been finalised, Amy.
Jason, I think that depends really on what the outcome of the report is and what the purpose of the investigation was. Because if you have an investigation that is conducted pursuant to an internal process, it may well be that the answer is found in the internal process. It might be that certain matter proceeds to a disciplinary stage, or it might be that a grievance is upheld or rejected, in which case you'd need to offer an appeal and so on. If you're not in a case that's governed entirely by an internal process, then I think it's a question of thinking about, why did we go down this road to start with? What was the purpose of the investigation? Because it may well be that it's appropriate to escalate the report internally, whether to board level or to a whistleblowing champion if you have one, or to those involved in compliance. And I'm sure Colin will speak to this in a moment. But that needs a sort of in the round assessment of where you stand in light of the findings of the investigation.
And Colin, your name's been called
yes.
In vain.
Well, no, certainly if you've concluded your investigation and you've previously felt that you've met the threshold for making the FCA aware that you'd started an internal investigation under Principle 11, telling them you were doing that, then you should also, of course, tell them what the outcome of that investigation was. Regarding the point earlier that Amy was making regarding privilege, the FCA itself does recognise that firms have a legitimate right to assert privilege, but does ask them to consider very, very carefully when they do so, and whether or not they might grant a limited waiver of privilege in certain circumstances to make their own considerations of the issues that much easier, and for them to get to the bottom of the facts of what's happened. When you're telling the FCA what the outcome is, it's very important the firm is also able to identify any remedial action or next steps that it is going to take if whatever has been complained about has disclosed any, certainly if it's disclosed any systemic failures within the firm or any improvements improvements that need to be made in the way of policies and procedures or internal trading or other next steps. But it's very important for the firm's senior management to be able to show the FCA that they are being proactive.
Thank you, Colin. And we are 12 seconds over, so there remains time only for me to thank our panel, Colin Sharpsmith, Amy Rogers and Jenny McGrandall. Thank all of you for listening to us. And Amy told me that tradition dictates that I have to finish on a haiku. I don't know any haiku except this one, which is writing a poem of 17 syllables is sometimes quite diff. And with that, thank you, everyone.